It's a great pleasure to be here and see so many enthusiastic faces. When I was at the stage of my career that many of you younger people are now, I kind of wondered whether I would ever do anything of any use to anybody, and by a series of luck and judgment by other people, I'm here before you today. And as you can see, I'm going to talk about something called the Mendez Principles of Effective Interviewing. I will explain what that's about. And you will realize, I hope, by the end of my 45-minute presentation today, that what I'm going to talk about is the result of hundreds of people's research from all around the world, including some people of the same age as you. And so if you ever feel like I did when I was an undergraduate and graduate student of, what's the point of all this? I'd rather be going down the pub or playing football or something. Then resist the temptation and do some good work, because your good work will contribute in some way towards some other worldwide principles that will be developed in the future, perhaps about arson. We were hearing about your work on arson over coffee this morning. So you're probably aware that in the United Nations there are a number of conventions that almost every country in the world has signed up to. One that's very relevant to parts of psychology, which I'm not going to talk about today, is the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child. And basically what that convention says, as you may already know from your knowledge of developmental psychology, it says the well-being of the child is always the most important thing, irrespective of anything else. And for each of these conventions, and there's a convention on torture and other cruel, inhumane, or degrading treatments, I just call that the Anti-Torture Convention. The United Nations appoints some very worthy person to the role of special rapporteur for just 5 years with regard to that convention. And one of the things the special rapporteur for the Child Convention or for this Anti-Torture Convention does during their five-year period is they progress things and they visit countries which have signed up to that particular convention to find out how things are going in those countries. And of course, many countries who are members of the United Nations are far poorer than the UK, even though we're quite poor at the moment, or richer countries like Canada. Everything's so expensive here. Anyway. And so the special rapporteur, Juan Mendez, a law professor, oh, it says that there, does it? Yes. He finished his 5 years in 2016. In 2014, he produced another report, and in that report in 2014 was a list of all the countries in the United Nations that had signed up to the Anti-Torture Convention, and it's about 200 countries. And for each country, he indicated where, to the best of his expertise and his colleagues, that country was following the convention. And it won't surprise you to know that a large number of countries that had signed up to this convention were nevertheless aware or indeed condoning cruel, inhumane, and degrading treatments, including torture. Off the record, when he was visiting those countries and said, "You've signed up to the convention, but I have found out that you know there's torture in this country," and they said, "Oh, yeah." He said, "Why? How come your government has signed up, but you, whoever you are, including heads of government, you are still allowing torture in your country?" And they gave the common sense view, which is, well, people who have committed serious crime or are planning serious crime, the common sense view is they would never spontaneously tell you. So the common sense view, and there's a brilliant book by Richard Leo on false confessions where he makes the good point that the common sense view is if somebody has committed a serious crime or planning a serious crime, they're not going to tell you, so you have to force it out of them one way or the other. That's the common sense view, and that's what these people in these countries were saying. So he then thought, in 2014 report, I wonder if there is another way of getting relevant information instead of torturing people. And so from 2014 to 2016, he and his team looked into this, and his final report said this. So the special rapporteur, so universal protocol is United Nations speak for a document for worldwide use. And you'll see that he's proposing that this document apply to many organizations, not just what we might call ordinary street police, but all sorts of other agencies that investigate even more serious crime than the average patrol officer would do. And he made the point, and you can see I'm quoting here, some states, he doesn't mean parts of the United States, that's United Nations speak for countries. So some countries have moved away. And Canada is one of those countries. You may be well aware that there have been a lot of developments in parts of Canada and throughout Canada. The RCMP produced an up-to-date manual, which has 200 pages, which of course it's secret, so I haven't seen it, have I? Anyway, I hear that in that document, it adopts this kind of perspective that he's advocating. And I will explain in a minute why in my colleague and I, Amy, in our country, England and Wales, we had to develop something called the peace model. I will explain that in a minute, several years back. And in his report, what he's saying is that the basic principles, the philosophy, the methodology, the skills within what we call the peace model of interviewing, in his opinion, was an example of what the protocol might look like. So how come in England and Wales we had to develop something that he thought was quite a good idea? Well, what happened was in the 60s and 70s in England and Wales, there were some very notorious cases. There were very few, but like you, Amy and I live in a pseudo-democracy where the media are relatively free to criticize the police and the government. And the media had picked up on some high-profile cases in England and Wales where people were convicted, but the appeal court accepted that their confessions were coerced out of them. Not really by horrible torture, but just by hitting them or threatening them in some other way. You know, if we don't tell us you did it, you know, we know where your parents live and all sorts you can imagine. So there wasn't real physical torture, but there was, you know, psychological manipulation. And so in the 1980s, the government in England and Wales, allied with the chiefs of police, they thought, something needs to be done. So the government brought in a law which mandated, as you can see here, from 1986, that in the country where Amy and I live, all the interviewing of suspects initially had to be audio taped, and nowadays in serious crime, it's videotaped as well. And in the few years after 1986, now that recordings were available, understandably, the police didn't let anybody in and listen to the recordings, but there were five or six research studies, two done by police officers for their PhD, very groundbreaking decades ago, for police officers while they're police to do a PhD. And there were two or three government-funded projects, so those projects did get access to the recordings of interviews conducted soon after 1986. And those studies found a very similar thing, which was the interviewing didn't seem very skilled. It was no longer coercive or oppressive because the relevant legislation that brought in this also mandated that a suspect is allowed to have their lawyer present during the interview, during the interrogation. You don't have that yet in Canada, do you? You do.
He's not going to be
It's coming. The law also mandated, you know, you can only interview for 2 or 3 hours, and there has to be a break. The person must not be sleep deprived or food deprived or everything. So it's a big piece of legislation, including, as I've said, the mandating of recordings. And so then there was the question, how come these very well-conducted studies, you know, if you're doing a PhD, as some of you are, or many of you have done, I can see some people not as old as me, but they're no longer 21 in the audience, and they probably, like Nadine, have a PhD. And, you know, a PhD has to be pretty good for it to be awarded. So the two police officers who did the PhD and the other research, it was methodologically really good. So everybody had to accept the finding that they're not very skilled, these interviewers. And then people said, well, that's weird. I wonder why that is. I wonder why they're not very skilled. And there was an obvious answer. They didn't really have any training. You know, they would join the police service, and when they became an interviewer, like a detective, they would just listen and watch other people doing it. So they had no formal training. So what's crucial about research that you are involved in or you will be doing is that it sometimes does create the need for a big change. And this research of finding people to be unskilled brought about, as you can see here, a major change. So what happened, because, you know, England and Wales is a relatively small country, I think we could fit into any of the parts or provinces of Canada very easily. I was once giving a talk in Texas, and somebody pointed out the whole of the UK can fit into Texas. So we are a small country, so it's easier to organize things. And so the Association of Chiefs of Police and the government, they asked 12 very experienced investigators, and I knew about this because, embarrassingly, I've always worked at a university, but just over a year ago, some of my closest friends in England organized a dinner on my behalf. It was really embarrassing because it was to celebrate the fact that I had worked with the police for 50 years. So anyway, so I knew a lot of police for various reasons, not to do with this topic. And when I was told the 12 experienced investigators that were going to spend a year or two doing nothing else but developing training and the philosophy of training, I had two joint concerns about them. The first concern is they were all men. And at least the females in the audience will know how useless men are at interpersonal skills. They have tunnel vision, narrow-minded, don't ask open questions, all those important things. Women are much better than that, as you probably are aware. So I thought, oh dear. Sorry, I nearly used bad language. They're all men. And some of them, if you know about criminal stereotypes, you know, if you ask the public what a drug dealer looks like, they have a certain notion. And if you say what a fraudster looks like, they say a fraudster looks like a priest or a bank manager. So you have this kind of appearance stereotypes, you probably know about that. I have to tell you that some of these 12 detectives look more like criminals than criminals do. You know, I thought, oh dear, what are they going to come up with? And perhaps a police officer who was not part of the 12, a guy called Tom Williamson. I need to tell you a little bit about Tom, even though time is limited. So this guy was born and raised in Scotland and lived on what's called a croft. That's a small farm that only produces enough for the family. There's no profit in it, and you know, in some years it's really bad. And he was the eldest of the children. So he left school at 14 and was told, go away, we can't feed you anymore. So he came from Scotland to London. And in those days, when you were on your 16th birthday, you could become what was called a police cadet. So you weren't a police officer till 18, but you did all your training from when you were 16. So he joined the London Police Service and was realized very quickly that he was a rising star. You know, he was gifted in many ways that his schooling and family background didn't enable him to do. And I don't think they do it now, but the London police used to, about one or two persons a year were chosen to be offered the opportunity to go to be a full-time student. So while he was a police officer, he came to university, this guy, Williamson, to be a student, to get his bachelor's. And he did something really weird and crazy. He didn't do law, he didn't do business studies, didn't do organizational behavior. What did he study? Psychology. And of course, whilst he was studying psychology, he was able to take on board that which he thought was particularly directly relevant to policing, and that, as I felt when I was a student, that which was useless. So he was now, having got his bachelor's several years ago, he's now head of the murder squad in London, which at that time was the biggest murder squad investigation in the world. So he's a real police person, but he happens to be one of the very few who's got a degree in psychology. And what he realized was that whereas in 1990, around the world, there was almost no research, let alone research of quality, on the topic of interviewing suspects, Williamson realized from his undergraduate days and his police experience that there were some parts of psychology that could assist the people coming up with training about how to interview suspects. So if you can remember anything you have learned as an undergraduate or a master's student or a PhD student or a postdoc, you might remember you studied things like attitude change. And attitude change from the 1950s was used in the applied field of selling and marketing and political persuasion. There was work in psychology, in clinical and counseling psychology, about how to assist a person who's having life difficulties who may not want to tell you about it, to, of their own free will, tell you about it. And there were various arenas. And Williamson had the fantastic idea that the 12 men tasked with producing something useful for interviewing might benefit from knowing about psychology, because I don't think any of them had a degree in psychology. So what Tom did was he got three psychologists and a couple of other detectives, and we met on Sundays, and what Tom said was, get anything that's valid from any area of psychology, and we're going to put it into a collection, and Stephen Mostyn translated it from academic, boring, long-winded stuff into everyday language. So the 12 detectives, I think, as I say, I think two of them had a degree in something, so they would understand it. And Mostyn did a really good job. So we produced this book. It's never been published, and Williamson gave it to the chairperson of the detectives. And we had no idea whether they would take any notice of it or not. But as you can see in the second paragraph, several months later at my office, a big parcel came. And I thought, oh, that's nice. It's not even my birthday. And when I opened it, it was from the 12 teams of detectives. And they said, dear Professor, we have decided to incorporate a lot of what the Williamson Committee passed to us, but we have been charged with producing training and philosophy. Maybe that was my fault. I just touched something accidentally. Thank you. I'll carry on. So where am I? Oh, yeah. So they had drafted things, like they drafted two booklets of about 20 pages in big print. And these two booklets were to be given to every one of the 127,000 police officers in England and Wales to say, from 1992, this is how you interview, but it might take 10 years before you're chosen to be interviewed. You know, if you're not in a part of policing where you would normally be interviewing suspects, you're not going to be trained first. And so what they said was, we have been told that our training booklets and everything else. We must have no sentences with more than 10 words. We must do our best to avoid any words with more than 2 syllables. But we have decided to incorporate loads of that psychological stuff, but we're not sure in everyday street language we have got it correct. So could you read through all this stuff and tell us where we've made a mistake? And it was amazingly wonderful. I mean, I'm always guilty. I've been head of the Department of Psychology at a number of universities, and I'm as guilty as anybody of not assessing graduates on their ability to communicate psychology to the general public, which is something that's very important, but somehow most universities neglect to do that. But if I've been grading these detectives for their ability to communicate psychology to my grandma who left school at 12, it was brilliant. So everything that's in the 92 documents and which have been updated since, and you can easily find them if you just Google interviewing guidance police England, you can access the documents. They're not confidential. So they came up with the acronym PEACE. If you remember your work on as a psychologist on how to memorize things, you know, the acronyms, oh my God, I've got an exam, I hate this topic, how am I going to remember anything? And you work out these little acronyms that help you remember, and that's very common in policing. And so they came up with the acronym of PEACE. And at one level, they did that on purpose, because they had come to the conclusion that with our new legislation and what they learned about how to get people to tell you stuff that initially they may not want to tell you, like in the training of medical doctors, for example, that I was involved in the 80s. So some people think it was kind of liberal-minded, non-conservative university persons like me that came up with this word peace. No, it was these dangerous-looking guys who came up with this idea of peace. And luckily, the 5 stages of what they said an interview should look like fitted in with it, but I'll tell you about a little mistake they made. So peace, what they basically say, and this may not surprise you at all, is that you are more likely to have success in getting a suspect to give you some relevant information if your organization gives you the time to plan and prepare properly. There wasn't any research on that, but there was research in other domains, but not in policing. And when I said that people like you have contributed to what I'm going to be talking about from all around the world, there have been surveys of very experienced investigators who have had no training in their life. And when those experienced investigators are asked, what's the most important thing you can do in order to ethically get information from suspects, they say, to be allowed the time to plan and prepare. And these detectives knew that, but there wasn't much research on it at the time, but they emphasized that. So you do that before the interview. And then, of course, when an interview starts in many countries, not just democracies like Canada and UK, you have to explain to the suspect their rights. You have the right to remain silent, you have the right to have a lawyer present, you know, you have this right, that right. So you explain. And then they said you engage the person in conversation. You don't rush into the topic, even though there's time pressure. You don't rush to get an account, because you're more likely to get an account if you first of all engage the person in conversation. But I worried about the word engage, because it may be the same in Canada. When you go to the toilet to sit down, it can be engaged, or you can get engaged. And there are hundreds of studies on this, to engage. But the correct word, of course, is a French word. It is the word rapport. But the 12 male detectives, quite rightly, couldn't bring themselves to use a French word, because there's a bit of history between the UK and France that's lasted about 1,000 years, you know. We love each other, we have a love-hate relationship. And they said, if we put a French word in, some people may not read further. So they had to have this word engage, but the word is rapport. So you develop a rapport. It's a bit like when you go dating, you know, you have to develop some rapport before you get onto what you really want to do. And again, there's loads of research now from all sorts of cultures showing that the crucial role of rapport in assisting a person to decide to tell you something they may not have initially wanted to tell you, but I'm going to come back to that later. And it said only when you have engaged a person in conversation is it worth trying to get an account. And within the account phase, there's lots of detail about different kind of question types, you know, open questions, closed questions, false choice questions, leading questions. I won't bore you with all that. You probably know that already anyway. And then when the person has finally stopped talking to you, if you're skilled enough to get them talking, the account apparently is over. And then traditionally, that's when the interview would have finished. But these guys said no. You then, with the person, have this other phase called closure, which has two parts to it. One drawn from memory, which is, if you've told me information, when I summarize and give it back to you, you can correct me. If I'm skilled enough to get you to give me a lot of information, I won't remember it all. So when I then summarize, you say, but I told you where I was on Monday as well. Oh yeah, so you did, right, thank you. And also we know from memory that if you've got something to summarize, when you're summarizing, it will cue off in the other person's memory more information. So that's the first part of closure. And the second part of closure goes back to rapport, which is in serious crime, even though the interviewing may have been done well, you may often need to talk to that person again about some other related thing. So you want them to leave the interview with you in what's called as positive frame of mind as possible. But if it's the only interview, given that you have reason to believe they're a suspect, because you have to have reason for them to be a suspect in a democracy, they're going to go back to their gang or their friends or their family who are going to say, how did those bastards police treat you? And you're going to say, guess what? They treated me with respect. So it's a kind of public relations part of closure as well. So then the interview finished and they said, but there's one more thing you should always do. And because it's all audio taped and videotaped, then you can do some self-evaluation, or you have a trusted buddy. And when you're somewhere, I was about to say in the pub, but you wouldn't do it in the pub. When you're somewhere, you can show your or listen to your interview and say, you know, give me the feedback. What do you think I did well? What do you think I did poorly? And of course, a buddy is more trusted than a supervisor, because by definition, the supervisor doesn't do it anymore. So what do they know? So we advocate kind of buddy peer evaluation. So that's what peace is. Okay, I'm on schedule. So why did Professor Mendez in his 2016 report say it was a useful exemplar of what this worldwide document, which I'm going to talk about in a minute, why did he say that? Well, it might be partly that it kind of makes sense. What I've just explained to you, I hope, kind of makes sense, particularly from a psychological point of view. But more crucially, is it any use? Because it contrasts very much with the old-fashioned view that you have to beat information out of a suspect. As I said, it's a bit more like what you do in dating or when you go and see your granny. And so in some cultures, when I'm explaining it, everybody's going, particularly police service in Outer Mongolia, I just made that up, that's not the real country. They're going, till I get to this part, which is it effective? So the first piece of research I had, I'm not gonna bother you with a slide about it, was not looking at its effectiveness in terms of getting information. We did a big project on this kind of interviewing is new for experienced detectives. So how easy is it then for them, when they're being a macho detective with the deputy leader of a gang of criminals, how easy can they behave like a woman? Ask open questions, have rapport, listen, pause, not rush. And So the first people who were trained in this method in 92 to 93 were those who interview suspects in the most difficult of circumstances. And then I, assisted by a person who got her PhD with me called Julie, we then analysed a random sample of interviews and found out what they could do well, the majority, and what they didn't do or did poorly that they should be doing, which then fed back into the training. Because what's easy to do, you don't spend much time on training. The important stuff that's difficult, like men asking open questions, you need to spend much more time on that. But we didn't evaluate the effectiveness of it. So the first person who evaluated the effectiveness was Dave Walsh. Now Dave, in his 40s, had been for 25 years an experienced government inspector of a certain kind of crime. So he had exactly the same training as the police. He was not a police officer because he investigated only certain kinds of fraud. And he contacted me. I'd met him once or twice. I knew he had two masters and a bachelor's degree in psychology, not in psychology, in technology. And he said he was thinking of doing a PhD. And I said, well, you're really successful. You know, you're like the deputy head of the national organization. What do you want to do a PhD for? He said, I'm nearly up to the 30 years. And in the UK, after 30 years, but I understand in the police in Canada, it's only 20 years. But in England, in the police and other investigative agencies, to get a full pension, you have to do 30 years. So he's at year 25 in his 40s. And he sensibly thinks, well, I'm not going to die soon. What am I going to do when I retire? And he had the crazy idea of wanting to become a university professor. I tried to put him off it because he was under the false impression it was easy. Because when you're on that side, you don't see all the administration and the dean and other faculty members have to do. You don't see all the crap. You just see the interesting bit. So I told him about all the rubbish and he still wanted to do it. So he decided to do a PhD, and because he was still working in the investigative agency, he had access to a large random sample of interviews that he was able to evaluate as a major part of his PhD. So the first study we published, you can see that, so he and a separate interrogator, they listened to all the 142 interviews. And they evaluated them for about 30 of the essential skills that are in the PEACE method that's in the training to see how closely each interview matched to what they should be doing, because they'd all been trained in the new method, and compared that with the outcome, which is, you know, to what extent you get a relevant, comprehensive account, remembering that some people are actually innocent. So it's as important to get an incriminating account from a guilty person as it is to get a non-incriminating account from an innocent person. And of course, that's where torture is not very good, because if you're being tortured, you make up anything to stop the torture. I don't think I've bored you with any more. Yeah. So Dave did four or five studies, one looking at rapport in these real-life interviews, and he found that So imagine yourself as a police investigator and you're going to interview this guy and you have good reason to believe this guy has sexually abused several children. So you already know that before the interview. You're pretty sure you've got interviews with the children. Unfortunately, you may have found videos on the guy's computer, highly incriminating. Sorry, I'm getting a bit emotional now. Calm down. Right. So how do you establish rapport with somebody you want to punch in the face, or worse? So establishing rapport with suspects is not necessarily easy. And if you're really skilled, and they start telling you about what they've done, it's very difficult to maintain rapport with that person. So what they found was, in the interviews which are good at establishing rapport, they were three times more effective in getting information than the interviews in which rapport was poorly established. But more importantly, in a smaller proportion of interviews where rapport was built and maintained in the face of pretty horrible stuff sometimes, they were 5 times more likely to get a comprehensive account. So that was one of the first studies, and there must be more than 100 studies around the world on rapport now. I mean, some of them are pretty crappy because they do it with students, and of course you only need rapport when one or both of the people in the interaction needs rapport. You know, if you interview a student, do you like orange juice? And you find rapport is not effective. Well, not surprisingly, you didn't need it. Anyway, enough of that. So another person who did her PhD with me, Sam Leahy Harland, it took us 3 years to negotiate access to, I think it was interviews with murderers and or rapists. I think there were 56 suspects. And as you can imagine, because these are very serious crimes, some of these interviews with breaks were pretty long. You know, an interview might have half of it today and half of it tomorrow. So poor old Sam had to code all these interviews for, I think we had 30 different skills, some of which are in the peace method and some are taught in other countries in an old-fashioned way. And by this time, because of the research of others, a police officer called Andy Griffiths, supervised by my very good friend, Professor Becky Milne, they realized, and then we talked about it, that not everybody can become good at anything. Not everybody can become a good interviewer, particularly of witnesses, victims, and suspects. And so before Sam's study, the police in my country, having taken note of psychology again, realized that, we need different levels of skill. So, you know, we have different levels of skill for people. You know, police in the UK don't normally carry guns, and you have to have certain skills to be allowed to carry a gun. And only certain people can be high pursuit police car drivers, you know, driving through the center of London at 120 miles an hour. You have to be highly selected for the abilities to do that. And the police realized that interviewing is such a breadth of skill that even the best police officer may not be able to ever become a good interviewer. You know, when I supervise graduate students, I say, we're going to be really pleased if you passed by 1%. There's nothing wrong with just passing. You know, you may want to do better, and I'll help you, but there's nothing wrong with being average. And so we conveyed to the police that we're going to have 5 levels of skill, but if you're stuck at level 1 because your recordings don't show you're very good, that doesn't mean you're useless. It means we won't put you in a situation which is too taxing for you. So we have 5 levels of skill, and we have experience and different levels of training. So when you get to level 3, you've had many weeks of training and role-playing and video recording and feedback about interviewing. And to interview in crimes of murder or rape, you have to be at least level 3. So these interviewers, we know they're very skilled because we've got recordings of what they've done in their career. And so one of the things they're very much trained to do at level 3, and this is partly research I did with another friend of mine called Coral Dando, is that in your planning and preparation, by definition, in the democracy, to have somebody as a suspect, you must have reasons to suspect them. Doesn't prove they did it. So you have information about them. And one issue is, when do you tell them everything you know? Obviously, you're required by law to explain to them and their lawyer some of the reasons you suspect them. But you don't have to tell them anything, everything, particularly pretty inconsequential things, like the crime was on Thursday, we happen to know where you were on Monday, but there's no relationship. So when I ask you where you are on Monday, I happen to know where you were, you don't know I know. And then depending on what you say, I then present the evidence and I challenge them. So in these complex interviews, they did what they were supposed to do. They had difficulty asking open questions. So the crucial thing is, you know, what skills are most related to what the suspect does that the interviewer wants? And you can see here, that again, we have a rapport. I can't speak French. empathy, asking open questions. Now, one of the things that experienced criminals do is, if they're being recorded, if it goes to trial, they know the jury can find out that whenever you ask a question, you exercise your right to silence, which you're allowed to do. But members of the public think that's very suspicious. So what experienced criminals do, or they're trained to do, is they will talk to the police officer around the topic, but not on the actual topic. So it's very important skill in these serious interviews to get the person to respond relevantly. So that's what we did. Just very quickly, there's research in other countries. One of the groundbreaking studies is this one. So Ulf Holmberg, I had the pleasure of going to Sweden to be the main opponent of his groundbreaking PhD. And this is what he found. So the old style, you better tell us everything, it's bad for you, he found is counterproductive. He found a more domineering, ethically, of course Sweden's a cool country, the more domineering, what we call the more old style, the interviewing, the fewer people confessed. And the reverse of that is that the kind of interviewing that he knew about in the peace method, which some detectives in Sweden used because there was no national training in Sweden, some had become dominant, some had become humane. So he found humane was very important. Just to show it, it's not too constrained by which part of the world it's in. There's lots of studies in Asia now coming to the same kind of conclusion. A person recently got her PhD with me, Bianca. She analyzed real-life interviews with suspects in serious sex crimes. And she coded the interviewing for the amount of and types of cognitive empathy, understanding how this person has got to where they are from your planning and preparation. And in two separate studies, she found a significant association between interviewer cognitive empathy and the amount of relevant information the sex crime suspect said. Very briefly, a study. You read some studies and you think, oh my God, that is so brilliant. I would never have thought of that. So a friend of mine, Mark Kebble, did this study in Australia, where basically he went into prison and had a questionnaire and talked with people in prison now about their interrogation. And this was really groundbreaking stuff. That though the general public think a person would never choose to tell you, this was the first study that kind of went, oh, maybe it's not every guilty suspect who is unwilling to talk. And the 50% who said just before their interrogation they had not yet decided whether to deny, stay silent, or talk relevantly, when they said, what are you waiting for? There was two things. One's obvious. I was waiting to see how much evidence they had against me, and I was waiting to see how they treated me. And very recently, with Professor Haley Cleary in the United States, Haley managed to get access to two jails, and because of her enormous skill, got over 550 people recently put in jail. To fill in a similar questionnaire with permission that Mark Kebble did in Australia. You can see here that though a larger proportion planned to deny than in Australia, 36% said I was waiting for those kind of things, but 25% said that their intent prior to the interview was to tell the truth. But if you walk into an interview and the police officer punches you in the face as the first thing you do, you say, F you, I'm not going to tell you even though I thought I would. Which goes back to Holmberg's finding that, you know, dominant treatment causes people to react negatively. And this is very psychological. You heard of psychological reactance that was first studied in marketing and selling in the 1950s? If I want you to stop buying Wizzo wash powder and buy my wash powder, I don't come round to your house, set fire to it and say, yeah, I told you, buy my wash powder. You do it very subtly, very peacefully. So, I'm going to conclude now in 3 minutes. Yeah. So we've got time for questions. Because I've heard all this before, but I haven't heard your questions. So please ask some questions. So what happened? The United Nations voted to accept the idea that a document be written. And so in 2017, a small committee was set up, which I was lucky enough to be on. And we spent like 3 years drafting the thing. We were told that nothing will be voted on by the United Nations if it's longer than 40 pages of double space Times New Roman 12. So imagine getting everything you know about interviewing and everything you know about the laws of anti-torture and 15 so-called world experts into 40 pages. Almost impossible task. And I think you can see here that when we thought we'd finished it, it was over 100 pages, and then we had to cut it down. So you can find this document if you Google Mendez Principles. And when you read it, whether you're a legal background or a psychological background or a police background, you will realize that not everything is there. Some of it's brief. So we had to cut out everything in the 100 pages was essential, but we had to reduce it. That's the world of real life indications from psychology. So within that document, there is a whole section that I'm not expert on about the negative effects on the brain of torture. Professor O'Mara, who happens to be in Dublin, has written books on how torture actually alters the way the brain works. So it talks about that. So there is a body of research cited in the document that talks about why this is ineffective. Then it talks about effective. And you'll see how important rapport is. Yeah? So those were two direct quotes. This is a bit of a summary of what it says. That this is what it's advocating that investigators do. And my final slide. So you can see here, these references are the ones I know about because we wrote them. But there are many, many other references now that underpin everything that's said here. And there's an article in the journal Memory which shows the exponential rise around the world on research on this topic. So I think that's the end. Yes, so I'll have time for questions.